homage to Buddha, the enlightened one. Gratitude to the Sangha for preserving and propagating the Dhamma. Gratefulness to all the devotees and donors for supporting the Sangha and thereby supporting the dispensation of the Buddha. My topic was given as a Buddhism, a moral science. Yeah. So I have called it a moral science. As you know, science, when you define it, is the knowledge or the application of the nature's laws. And nature's laws, of course, in the material world, there are many, and science is working on that. And now we have started working on the psychological side of it also. But here, when I am talking about Buddhism, a moral science, so Buddhism should not be taken just as a religion, but it is a moral science. And also, if you have read Dr. B. R. Ambedkar, he has very rightly said that what is God to other religion, morality is to Buddhism. So in Buddhism, there is no God. In place of God, what we have in Buddhism is morality. So that is the importance given in Buddhism. Further, I would like to add that what is soul in other religions, rationality is in Buddhism. That means, what is God and soul to other religions, morality and rationality is to Buddhism. So whatever we see from the moral point and from the rational point. This is not just to condemn others, but to take it in a very scientific way. And this, as we said, this moral science, what is the purpose? When we say we educate people, that means we make them civilized. And once people become civilized, then there is a possibility of creating a peaceful world, a happy world. So if you are talking that Buddhism or the Buddha's message for the universal peace and happiness, then what is the process that one has to follow to gain that very peace and happiness? To put it in Buddha's own words, in short, we can say one of the verses from Dhammapada where he says, Sabba papasa akaranam kusalasa upasampada sachitta pariyodapanam etang buddhana sasana. What is the teachings of the Buddha? Sabba papasa akaranam, to avoid all evils. Kusalasa upasampada, to perform wholesome deeds. Sachitta pariyodapanam, to purify one's own mind. Etang buddhana sasana. These are the teachings of all Buddhas. So sabba papa sakaran, to avoid all evils. Now the question arises, what are those evils? Are we going to make a list of it? And if you start making a list of it, it will go in hundreds and thousands. So it is an impossible task. But then there is a root for all these evils. If you can avoid that, then rest of the things can be dealt with. Like for example, if there is a poisonous tree with all its fruit, branches and leaves, if you go on cutting the leaves, the branches, again it may sprout out. The easiest thing is just you cut the roots. You destroy the roots and you'll see the whole tree will dry out and die out sooner or later. So with a minimum effort, you can destroy this poisonous tree just by striking at the root of that tree. So similarly, there are many evils. If you make a list, there are hundreds and thousands of evils. But if you want to cut those all evils, you strike at the root of those evils. And what is that? That's nothing but given in the five precepts. That is to abstain from killing, abstain from stealing, abstain from sexual misconduct, abstain from false speech, abstain from all kinds of intoxicants. These are the things. If you can avoid these things, then the whole other evils are bound to fall away, because you are striking at the very root of all evils. So therefore, when we say sabba papa sakaranam, you need not quite count all the evils, just count these five precepts that are given. That is given in don'ts. Don't do this, don't kill, don't steal, don't sexual misconduct, don't speak false, don't take intoxicants. So these are all in don'ts. in the negative sense. Then the second verse says, kusalasya upasampada, perform the wholesome deeds. Now what are the wholesome deeds? Now if you analyze, you'll see that the very other side of the five precepts is a wholesome deed. Or in Pali we say, varita sila and charita sila. Varita, that means you practice sila by abstaining from that. That means given in don'ts. And when we say performance, that what you do. So on one hand, you avoid the evils. On the other hand, you have to do something and perform good. So what are those goods? Again, if you go on counting, it's a big list. So what are the good things that you have to do? Again, you can take the example of a tree. If there's a good fruitful tree, very nice tree, let us say mango tree, if you want to take care of it, you need not go on taking care of the leaves and the fruits and all. Just you take care of the roots. You give good manure, you give good water, have a good fencing, and the tree will grow and give you good fruits. So similarly, what are the good things that you have to perform so that all other goods will follow it? So if you take these very five precepts, the first precept says to abstain from killing. Okay, you don't kill. Then what you do, the other side of it. The other side of it, just do something which preserves the life, which gives life. On one hand, you don't kill. On the other hand, you do something by which you preserve the life, you give life. Like for example, if someone is hungry, if you give him food, he will survive. If you don't give food, he may die. Or someone has met with an accident, you donate your blood. Thereby you save his life. If not, he may die. So like that, you on one hand, you don't kill. On the other hand, you do everything that is possible to preserve life, to promote life. This is kusala upasampada. Then coming to the second precept, you don't steal. Of course you don't steal, then you're a good person. But that is not enough. Stealing means it is something which belongs to others. You take it without his permission or forcibly. That is called stealing. So you don't steal. Then what do you do? That is only in don'ts. What is there that you have to do? That is nothing but charity. Dana. Your own things, the things which belongs to you, your own things, you donate for the good of others. You donate for the benefit of others. You donate for the welfare of others. So this is charita sila. This is the other side of the sila. So on one hand, you don't steal. On the other hand, you donate your own things for the good of others. Then the third one is to abstain from sexual misconduct. Of course, that's a good practice, but that's not enough. Then what is the other side of it? You don't sexual misconduct, lead a perfect family life, that's okay. But then what you do on the other side? This is where people don't understand what we can do. We are lay people living a moral life, committed to our wife. What else? But that is not enough. That is only in the what you call varita sila. Now from the charita sila point of view, what you have to do? You have to practice brahmacharya, celibacy. Now you may say, what Banteji, we are lay people. How come this celibacy applies to us? For monks it is okay. Where does it apply to us? But that's not the case. Of course, monks have to follow celibacy throughout the life. But Buddha has not exempted even lay people from practicing celibacy. This one should understand. Then you may say, how and when do we practice celibacy? Of course, as a lay people, yes, throughout your life you cannot practice celibacy. But as per Buddha's instruction, a lay person also has to practice celibacy at least 4 days in a month. We call them as Uposatha day. That is on the full moon day, the new moon day, the waning moon and the waxing moon, or we call Ashtami. These are the 4 days, Purnima, Amavasya and 2 Ashtamis. These are the 4 days on which even lay people have to practice celibacy. That is why on that day you have might have seen in Buddhist countries, and now also here this practice has started, that on this Uposatha days they take 8 precepts. Normally you take 5 precepts, but on Uposatha days you take 8 precepts. And when you take 8 precepts, the 3rd precept, Kamesu Michachara Veramani, becomes Abrahmacharya Veramani. On that occasion you are telling, you are not telling Kamesu Michachara Veramani, you are telling Abrahmacharya Veramani Sikkhapadam Samadhyam. That means you are telling, I will not behave in a way which is Abrahmacharya, which is not Brahmacharya. That means I will practice Brahmacharya. So therefore, at least the so-called Buddhists or Upasaka Upasikas, they should not think that we are exempted from this celibacy. No. At least 4 days in a month, even lay people have to practice celibacy. So on one hand, you do not sexually misconduct. On the other hand, or don't commit adultery. And on the other hand, you practice celibacy at least 4 days in a month. So this is Charita Sila. Now coming to the 4th. You should not speak false, backbiting and all other things. Of course you don't speak that. Then what do you speak? Now you might have seen on most of the occasions they are very good people. They don't speak false, but when the occasion arises, they don't speak even truth. Isn't it? They say, I have not spoken anything wrong. What is wrong there? But of course you are not spoken false. But when the occasion arises, you have to speak out the truth. So just abstaining from false speech is not enough. When the occasion arises, you should have that guts to speak truth, however bitter it may be. And the problem with the whole world is now that you don't want to speak the truth because it is bitter. People will not appreciate. People won't like. They will not get pleased. So we are almost trying to please people. Even with falsehood, if you are ready to please, you are going ahead with it. So on one hand, you should not speak false, but on the other hand, whenever the occasion arises, you have to speak truth. This is the other side of the sila. Now finally coming to the 5th one, you have to abstain from all kinds of intoxicants. That is true. But then what you should do? Now one person was telling that, okay, we will not take alcohol. Then what you will take? He said, I'll take juice, fruit juice. Well, that looks logical, but that's not the thing. When you're telling that don't take intoxicants, what we mean is don't take things which deludes you, which makes you unconscious. So then what you have to do? You have to do things which makes you aware, which makes you conscious, which makes you mindful. That means you have to practice mindfulness. It is not only avoiding intoxicants, on the other hand, you have to practice mindfulness. That is what we call satipatthana. Yeah. So as a Buddhist, you don't only avoid intoxicants, but you should also practice mindfulness. Whatever you do, you have to do mindfully. Speak mindfully, walk mindfully, eat mindfully. Because if you're not mindful, you're bound to make mistakes. You're bound to meet with an accident. If you're not mindfully driving, you may meet with the accident. So therefore, practicing mindfulness is important. So like this, these 2 sides of the sila, one is in terms of abstinence and the other side is in terms of performance. On one hand, that is called Varita Sila, you abstain from evil actions of body and speech. And on the performance side, you perform wholesome deeds. When you perform and also avoid, then only your sila is complete. Just if you practice Varita Sila, that is not complete. So therefore, when we talk of sila, we should talk both, not only just of Varita Sila, but also of the Charita Sila. Not only in terms of abstaining from evil actions of body and speech, but also from the point of view of performing good actions of body and speech. So this holistic attitude can create peace and harmony in the society. The whole problem that we face today, whether it be in our locality, whether it be in our society, whether it be in a nation or the whole world, why there is problem? Because people are not moral. This is the basic problem. It is not that people are not educated. It is not that people are well-to-do financially. Everything is there. And yet, there is no peace. There is no harmony. Therefore, there is a saying, where there are no morals, there are bound to be quarrels. So if you don't have morals, you are bound to quarrel with each other. Forget about one nation quarreling with the other. In the very family that you know, wife and husband will quarrel with each other. Parents and children will quarrel with each other. Why? Because there is no morals. So the basic necessity or requisite for a peace and harmony in the society or in the nation or in the whole world is morality. That is what is lacking. Whether we take in the name of society, the social leaders or the political leaders or even religious leaders, what are they lacking? Somewhere or other, if you peep inside your own hearts or in their heart, you will find it is the moral principles that are not being followed. Therefore, the whole mess in the society and in the nation. Normally, when you talk about morality or these five precepts, the common excuse given is, oh no, this is very difficult task. And especially nowadays in this Kali Yuga, we cannot practice this. This is a common excuse that is given. But then there are other people who are practicing it. Of course, few in number, but they are practicing it. Then how come they are practicing? And if you ask them, is this precept, following precept is very difficult? They say, no, it's easy. We are comfortable with it. Then how come that very moral five precepts is difficult to someone and easy to someone else? Then is this moral precepts really difficult? This is a question. But if we analyze, forget about only this moral precept, anything that you take, nothing is difficult in itself, nor nothing is easy in itself. When someone is saying that this is difficult, what it means is this person is not trained in it. He is not tamed in it. He has not practiced it. Therefore, it is difficult for him. And when someone says this particular thing is easy for me, what it means is he is trained in that. He is tamed in that. He has practiced that for a long time. Therefore, it is easy. So, how far you are training yourself in a particular field is more important. If you don't train yourself, let us say even a bicycle or a motorcycle, if you don't train, if you don't practice, whole life it will be difficult for you. But if you keep trying, you keep practicing, you keep training, sooner or later you become perfect in driving. Like for example, someone comes to the vihara and I give him a bunch of key and I say, here, take this key and take the car and go to the market and bring some vegetables. He says, no, Banteji, I cannot drive the car. And I tell him, why can't you drive the car? It's after all a machine. You can drive it. Come on, take these keys and drive. He says, no, Banteji, I can't drive it. And when I ask him, why you can't drive it? Then he says, no, Banteji, five things I have to do at a time. That is very difficult. So when I ask him, what are those five things that you have to do at a time, which is difficult? He says, no, Banteji, one leg I have to keep on the brake, one leg on the accelerator, one hand on the gear, one hand on the steering, my eyes onto the roads. These five things at a time. My goodness, I can't do it. Then that looks logical. Then I say, okay, if that's the case, then do one thing. You just join the driving school. They will train you. In a month, you'll get a learning license. And once you get the learning license, then you drive in open ground where there's no one. Then after you are comfortable with it, then you drive in an area where there is less traffic or less people. And after that, you try in an area which is full of traffic. And within a 6 month or 1 year, you are bound to become perfect. So he listens to my advice, he joins the driving school, he gets a learning license of the 1 month, after 1 month. Then he starts driving in the open ground, then where there is less traffic, and later on in the heavy traffic. And in 1 year, he becomes totally perfect. He becomes so perfect that not only now he's doing 5 things at a time, like one leg on the brake, one leg on the accelerator, hand on the grain, this gear, and another hand on the steering, and eyes on the road. Apart from these 5 things, he does another 6th thing. Do you know what? While driving, he speaks on the phone. Have you seen people doing that? Now you tell me, which driving school teaches you how to speak on phone while driving? Does any driving school teach you? No. That only means that you have become so perfect in 5 things that 6 things you do it automatically. No one need to tell you. So same simile can be used for the 5 precepts. You may say, oh, 5 precepts are very difficult. We can't do so many precepts. No, it is not difficult. It is only a matter of practicing. It is a matter of training. It is a matter of taming. If you are not going to train yourself, whole life you will be complaining, you will be giving excuses that this morality is very difficult, I cannot practice. So therefore, this morality or moral precepts, they are not difficult. And moreover, there is no one here to do policing behind you, that whether you are keeping this precept or not. Buddha is not a policeman standing behind you and telling, okay, you don't follow this precept, then I am going to bang you with two sticks and all these things. No, nothing of that sort. The very good thing in Buddha's teaching is these 5 are precepts. They are not commandments, mind you. These are 5 precepts, not 5 commandments. In commandments, there is a command. You have to do this. If you don't do this, you are going to be punished. You will be sent to the hell. You are threatening people. But in precept, there is no threatening. It is only you make them understand. You make them appreciate. Once a person understands and appreciates, he is bound to practice it. So therefore, what are precepts? Precepts can be defined as, precepts are nothing but a self-imposed discipline by the self to the self. It is not that someone is going to impose on you. He will only educate you. He will inspire you. He may encourage you. He will make you understand it. He will make you appreciate it. But he cannot force you. He cannot threaten you. So that's the very unique thing about precepts. Precepts are what? It is a self-imposed discipline by the self to the self. So for that, you have to understand and appreciate the advantages and the dangers in not practicing it, and advantages in practicing it. So in this way, if you understand things, see, the whole problem is of understanding. When you understand things, you start appreciating them. When you appreciate that, you are bound to put it into the practice. But if you are not ready to understand, then where is the question of appreciating? And if you don't appreciate, you are not going to put it into practice. So therefore, moral science, when you say, it is a science. It is not confined to one particular religion or one particular nation or caste or creed, nothing of that sort. This applies to all human beings. So when we say 5 precepts or Panchashila, it is not only for Buddhists. It is for whole of the humanity. All humans have to practice this. And all the laws that are made in countries, not only India, the so-called constitution, they are just to see that you practice these 5 precepts. The IPS sections and all, they are nothing but to protect these 5 precepts. So it is universal, you see. So this is the universal method to bring peace and harmony in the society, in the nation, in the world. We have so many peace accords, peace conferences. People are talking this and that, but are they discussing on these 5 precepts? Are they signing accord on these 5 precepts? If every nation signs an accord on 5 precepts, all the problems would be solved. Then we can have real peace and harmony in the whole world. So therefore, without taking much of your time, I think we are running out of time. Finally, to conclude, I would like to say that morality is a must. If not, person catches rust and society goes to dust. So do not let your emotions to burst and make you the worst, but be someone whom people can trust. And this trust comes from morality. Today, if we don't trust each other, it only means that we are lacking somewhere in morality. So if we want to create trust in each other, we have to practice morality. That is the only way that we can bring about peace and harmony in this society and in this world. With that, I conclude. Thank you.